Hi guys, the moment you've been waiting for. We're gonna start cutting. Before I start, just let me clarify the turntable. You've got the disc part and the bass part. Doesn't matter what shape that is, but make it slightly bigger, and then you can fix it, because you don't want this part to. You want this stable, so you'll be turning that. Moving your vice around, so that I've kind of do this with the one that I use normally, and just use those clamps to fix the base of it down. So you know, if you're going to do it permanently, you could screw that down, whatever. I had to change the few things. Like, it's all experimental for me as well, but I think we'll get some success. You see this can, it's got that ledge, so when you glued the coin down, it's lower than the surface, which it made it, I don't know if you may understand, the template. I'll probably do a bit of doodling, and when I do, I'll do it on these coins that are glued on. So the template, what it does, it creates a little facet, what they call a heel, and then so the heel allows you to the graver to cut without diving in. If you didn't have a heel, it would just go deeper and deeper and deeper and deeper, and it would stick. But with a heel, it's like a plow. That's the only analogy I can do explain. It, you know, it doesn't dive down. It carves a groove through the earth, but we're carving it through metal. I did on the original one, one of the other videos. This is what we're going to use as our hammer. Well, I am. You'll have to find whatever you can find. It's just a bit of, that's 22mm copper tube, just a bit, that olive that happened to be there, probably adds to the weight, and it just happens to fit my finger. So you'll have bigger fingers or smaller fingers. You'll have to find something to fit. Other things you can try, I tried, are, that's a bit of a, what's that, like an air, a CO2 thing. I cut the top while they're too small, and oh, where is it, I had a guitar slide, but it was a bit too heavy. You don't need a lot of weight. I mean, you can imagine what that weighs, you know. If you, that's a 22mm copper tube, and it measures, not very straight, that measures 44 millimeters, so whatever that weighs, so I'd say about 25 grams guessing, and that's all you need. So the action we're going to be using, it goes on, you probably could use it at, you know, how you feel comfortable, because you're going to hold it with, that's as close as I get, we're going to hold it with two fingers and then tap with that. And to be quite honest, it's exactly the same action as an airgraver. You know, an airgraver, you're holding it slightly different, but an airgraver has a tiny piston, like probably weighs the same amount as this, maybe less. And you know, it might, probably goes a lot faster, but I go as slow as I can with an airgraver for accuracy. Right, so to counteract that problem that was too low, I just glued another, what's that, three pennies, just to jack it up. But remember I mentioned you could put a wooden disc to make that stiffer, so if you did, you could do that raised up. I also did, it worked, when I did it before, it worked quite well. I did mention this in a previous video. You can manipulate, like as I mentioned, the heel. And in the instructions for this, I say set the distance between the surface of this to the point of 30mm, and that creates the heel. I measured it all on a CAD program. It may not be correct, you know, I've never measured it since, but according to the CAD program, it should have been whatever I said it was on the paper. So because of this problem where that was lower, I just drew it back, say 2mm, and then sharpened it again, and what that does, it creates a heel at a greater angle, so I can, you know, instead of using it at that angle and it's slightly awkward for me, I can use it at this angle. And incidentally, sometimes engravers use that. If you wanted to engrave in that low surface, then you would do even a higher hill, and then you could engrave with a graver right up like that, and it would still go, you know, cut a straight line. Anyway, let's get going. I'm not sure how I'll do it, because what it is, when you do a video, the file's so massive that it takes ages to process and upload. So I'll go through some of it, and then I'll probably narrate it, the whole thing, but I may fast forward it all. And if you've got questions, you can ask them. This device is working really well. I'm amazed. You know, that before I thought I would have to lean on the bottom to turn it, but that's just, I can tell, because I use, you know, I did make my other vice, but I know what a good turntable is supposed to do, and this is doing it just for nothing. I mean, it's just whatever I had lying around, and this is not as good as the ones you could buy, but it does the same thing. It rotates, you can see on the, like, I can put any part of that, right, so there's the date in the centre of view. Let's zoom in a bit. I'll put it on macro in a minute, but in fact I'll do that now. Right, so I have to set the camera. Right, so you see there the date. I'll put that in the view. I'll probably adjust this camera a bit. Right, the date is in the centre. You see it's rotating. Now all I have to do, let's do the eye. The eye is in the centre of the view. Oh no, his ear is. Anyway, let's do it for this. Right, oh yeah, he's here, right. So another part, I'll show you. Right, so this part here, I'll put in the centre of the view. There you go. So I could engrave a tiny, you know, if I wanted to do a tiny circle. No, the vice is doing the work for me. Oh yeah, just, I'm going to fire information at you as I remember it. I'm still learning myself, but what I've learned, I'll explain. In engraving, this hand stays almost stationary. It adjusts, the angle adjusts, and in some cases you tilt the graver, but we're not going to be concerned with that. The work moves. So, you know, they say the graver cannot engrave a curved line, but you turn the work, and then they say you create a curved line. But so that, get that in your mind. Don't, you're not steering this around. You're steering. So what I'll do, like I said, I'll do some doodling. So right, I'm gonna engrave on the edge of the coin. This isn't actually the angle on this. Isn't, I should start all this vice again, but I'm gonna persevere so that you make your one better. And then, you know. All right, here we go. Now you see, I do it without thinking now, but I'm moving the vice. I'm not. It's like a record player. So that my engraver's the needle, and the vice is the turntable. If you look at my videos, you know, I'm using the airgraver. You know, you can see that the view of the graver stays the same. If you start twisting the graver, you risk breaking your point, and that's, you know, you will do that, but don't worry, you'll get used to it. Anyway, right, I'll set up the camera up again, and we'll be cutting. Right, here we are. I'll try and get stuck in. If you're like me, all you wanted to do was start this. You didn't want all the other nonsense, but you'll do a bit, and then you refer back to it, and you think, oh right, so you just have to start, and then you see what you need to do or where you went wrong. Oh yeah, because I had to experiment with this. I've redone the picture on there, the transfer, so I did start a little bit so it won't matter, you know, you couldn't get it exactly in the same place. But what I normally do is you know, I could, that's quite, I'm quite impressed the way this come out. If you can discover a better carbon paper, because the lines are a bit thick. So if you could get some, I tried to put some pencil on the back of a bit of paper to see if that worked. Didn't seem to work, but there's probably a better way to make some kind of carbon paper, and you do a neat like print out, and you can put any image on there. A lot of times when you engrave, you just need, like, if you're not confident in drawing, I can't draw, so you need to know where the eye goes and the ear goes, rather than, you know, I know guys who can draw and they say it's still difficult to draw under a microscope. Right, so I'm gonna get cutting. I'll do it, and if I think of something to say, I'll stop. Oh yeah, what I was gonna say, so you don't need all the lines. What I do normally, I've got a little tablet next to the microscope, and if, you know, I'll be doing a design, but I'll have a photograph for that design. So the main lines are down, and once we've engraved it, do as many lines as you can, and then clean it off, and then refer back to your picture. I'm going to remind you, I'm just going to check that's this is how we check. This is before you start, I think that might be blunt. I'm going to keep going for a little while. Before I did it, it lasted the whole coin. But so this is the test to see if it's sharp. That's slipping a little bit, but I'm going to keep going anyway. I've started now. That's the temptation. You shouldn't do it, but I even do that with my other engraving. I go a bit too long, I'll pick up another engraver, so I'm going to keep going. Yeah, this angle, it's a shame. If I'd lifted that up a little bit more, I'd make a lot more success. But you can see, I couldn't do this pushing. I use an air graver exclusively. I couldn't do this. And if you hammer and chisel normally, you do actually move the graver. You'd have to be standing up, or with hammer and chisel, you have to use two hands. So it's tap, 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 move the vise, tap, tap, tap. But this idea, which I've never seen anywhere else, I'd imagine some Japanese or Chinese inventor did it years ago. But I'm going to rush this a little bit, but I think it'll come out. Oh, actually, I'm doing it two hands now. Just that, if I'd sorted that angle out, I probably could cut a continuous line, but it's just getting caught on the side of that tin. Right, so right, the way I carve, I'll explain, and then if you're not sure, just follow some lines. So I'm probably going to put too much detail in this for you. Just keep it simple. But always, the more you carve, the more you feel like, oh, just do a little bit more there, and just put a bit of angle on certain things, and you get carried away. But and you know, using this method, even the I use a GRS graver mark, you know, I'd have to have the pedal full down to cut that much. So this method, if you're artistic, there's nothing stopping you. So there's a little so he's got a that line there. I'm trying to work out, I'll do it so you don't make the same mistake. This line here is the brim of his hat. See that, the pattern makes it a little bit more confusing than it needs to be, but if I was doing that with a laser transfer, I'd do as many lines as I can. So what it does, there. I'm making up my own lines now. You know, if you see a flat cap, it's got a brim, and the rest is kind of, I don't know what the word is. I think I'm gonna next time I'm gonna get the lines down so I can clean this this blue stuff off, and then I'm gonna raise this up again. That'll be the next episode. But what I'll do now is actually, if you you see this, I just wanted to do that thing carved with an owl. I like the idea of that. That's what they reckon the old hobos used to carve. If I attach this to a handle, you know, like a pin vise or something, it would be longer, so I could lean it over the side of the vise. You know, you're still banging the end, so you know, you could cut the end of that, cut the end of the nail off, and then attach it to something like a chunky one of them. Chunky, like it needs to be bigger, that thing. So you could lock it in there, and it'd be so long, then I could really hang it over the side of the vise, and I'd have less stop starting or need to use two hands. Where are we? Got main nut. Yeah, see, all you need really is an outline. Oh, let's do the ear, so you know the ear. As I'm looking at the picture, and I've carved a few ears, I know how they, it's not a atomically correct ear, but let's have a look. So I don't know the names of anything. Right, so that's the outline. The outline doesn't match this line, but the line I carved, it's getting a bit right, I carved this. There's a line here. I'll just get out. I'll go over the line. I'll go through the line again. And I was just testing it if everything was working. Actually, that's this hammer and chisel technique. You're less likely to slip anyway. If you was pushing, I reckon that would slip. I'm going to do it here, so I'll do it. Oh no, it's still... Oh no, it is quite... No, there is a little... What you can do also, every now and again, if you find you're slipping, just clean your graver. It's not really... That's leather with some diamond... paste. I think I mentioned it before. It's not really sharpening it, but the graver is picking up metal. Before I forget, no one tells you this. You see gravers do it, they do it without thinking. When you're engraving sometimes, let's see if I can create it. Yeah, I've actually done it there. Now, can you see it? Oh, you can't. I think you can just about see it. See what I did there? Oh look, just see the colour there, that little bit there. That's a piece of the bronze. This coin is bronze. Let's see if I can do a big bit. Oh look, I'll exaggerate, see if I can do it. Is it there? Yeah. What sometimes happens, it doesn't with carbide, it seems, but with high speed steel and probably this and soft metals, you go to engrave and the engraver picks up a little slice of metal, kind of gets stuck to the end, and then it acts like a banana skin. When you go to engrave the next line, you slip. So you'll see, I bet if you've watched some videos, you see, I do it sometimes, you see the engraver touch it to his thumb, And some die engravers, they do it every time. They engrave in, that's what they're doing. They're wiping the chip off, whether there's one there or not. If you don't like the idea of that, I mean, you got a sharp engraver, you can cut your finger. I always thought you could stick a little bit of leather to the side of your vice and then use that instead of your thumb. But doesn't seem, I've never seemed to cut myself other than when I kind of swing the grave around and stab myself. But there's that, right, so that's that line. Right, so there's the outside of the ear, and then there's another line. It follows the curve of that, so even if you haven't got the line, because them lines are so thick they blur into one, so I'd say about a millimeter's width. Follow that round. See, I'm keeping the graver straight, I'm turning the vise with my left hand, or if you're right handed. Right, so you don't need to go. You see, I'm banging this. I think using the air graver has taught me a bit to even do this. I kind of know what's required without thinking to a certain extent. You don't have to hit so hard. You can tap very gently with this and do a nice line, and you can go over that line as many times as you like to get it the depth you like. So basically all we're doing here, really, you could go over this very lightly. Let's do his nose just very lightly, and then what you've done, you've made permanent lines here, so you can clean that off. The fear is when you first start, don't be tempted. When I engrave, I avoid it now that much, even when I've got a transfer on that doesn't come off. But if you wipe this, it will start smearing and make a mess, and then you'll be lost. You'd have a job to get it in the same place. So don't be tempted to wipe the chips off all the time, because you'll mess up your drawing. So we're going to just go through. If you've got a chip, also you're bound, if you're starting, that'll be like a cheese grater. It'll be sharp as anything. There'll be things sticking up and everything. But if you've got a burr sticking up, you just use your graver. Say that's sticking up there. You can go back and flick, keep going, and eventually that'll come off. Yeah, it flicks off. Right. So he's it. Oh yeah. Just so I explain. So his ear comes around there and it stops. And so it goes there, and then he's got that joins on to that bit, and he's got a bit that goes here. See, like I said, it's kind of like based on it's a caricature, but you see what I did there? He's got that bit. You've got that, an ear, so you've got an ear, it's like they say, if you learn to, it's like a question mark, so it goes round like that, and then it's got a bit there, like the dot of the question mark, and then the inside is like a Y. It's got, it has a little, you see that line kind of, I don't think that's meant to be there, but you have a little bit there. So let's say I've carved that little bit out there. I might be tempted to use a Dremel on this with a little diamond burr, because that's not, everyone can get a little these diamond, let me show you that while I'm at it as well. You get these cheap diamond burrs from eBay in a big big pack. Let's show you. Like that. These aren't the ones I use are screwed to the wall, but something like that, and they're really good. They're I wish they did a smaller one, but what I did, the smallest one, they come all different sizes. You can use them all, like I said, if you want to smooth the coin, you can smooth it and it takes a transfer better. But the very smallest one, because it's diamond, I heated it up red and then forged it, you know, banged it down, it probably just crushed the diamonds, but they're still in there. And I made it to about, that's probably 1.5 mil. And it's surprising you don't need that smaller one. I wish they would do some better quality ones and some smaller ones, but they don't. But it's good enough. And then the next one up, you could also use it. So if I, like I said, I could use that, which I might be tempted to do. I'll own up if I do it, and won't that be part of it? So you could clean the ear up. You've carved it, and then you clean it up, and you create contour. That's all we want. We want, you know, basic lines to follow, and then create contour. You know, that's the distinction between, in coin, let's say art coins, there's love tokens and hobo nickels. The distinction is, a love token is engraved, like a pencil drawing, and a hobo nickel is carved, which is a bas relief. So, you know, you've got to have some contours to kind of justify calling it a hobo nickel. All right, back to area. So it's got that little, it's actually more like a, it's like a Y, a V you're cutting out, but it creates a Y with what's left. I think I better stop. Right, so I've outlined that. I better not go. See, I overdo it. But right, so his hat. Shall I do the lines? Yeah, let's do the lines. So go. Like I said, you don't have to go too deep in one go, but go quite deep, because what we're going to do is, I mean, there's some to remove on this, but we're going to go over it with a Hisagi scraper. And the it kind of, I discovered that does the contour for you. So if you've carved a really thick line there and a thick line there, you kind of scrape it and it catches that corner and it cuts that corner off, and it does it instantly kind of makes it a carved look. You know, it's a simple way. You can, you know, you, when you get into it, you put subtle, you know, if you're doing a face, there's all subtle ups and downs in the face, so you kind of get a bit more ambitious. But just to start with, right, I think I'm trying to speed it up as much as I can and maybe do some more. Right, let's do his eye then. So his eye is, so I'm going gentle on the eye. I'll go deeper. But, eyes are good. You do a, when you create an eye, you leave a tiny little island and it creates a highlight and it really looks good. You know, it's if you look at sculptures, it shows up much better. You don't have to do a lot to make an eye look good. Let's go in a bit closer. Oh yeah, that's it, remember. You see, where as I come to the end, I do that without thinking now, but it's a little bit hard to, you know, this kind of method, but what you're trying to do is tidy up as you go. So there's a little burr there where I've carved a groove, you know, pushed the metal along. Oh god, I'll try and get a good view for you. Right, where I'll do it again. So there's a line here, right. So I think I might need sharpening. Sorry. Right. Yeah, right, I'm going to stop the video, I'm going to sharpen it again. Back again, and that's nice and sharp. I polished it this time. I've showed you my it's a sapphire stone. Let me just show you, if you notice the difference. This is the test. Oh, you can actually see it sticking my nail, yeah, it's good. So what? So if that slipped at all, it's not really sharp enough. So, you know, I went too long there, but it's too. Sometimes you do. If you make a mistake, it's your own fault. Right. Let's do these. What was I doing? Oh yeah, I was explaining about. Oh, you see. Oh my God, that cut so much better. I didn't polish it last. I went to about 2000 grit, but I thought I'd polish it because I can't work out why it's different than the last time I did it. Now let's get that in there. I want to zoom in, but then it keeps going out of view. But oh, it's not bad. Right. What was I explaining? Let's do his mouth. Oh yeah, popping a chip out. Don't, you know, engraving is only a few things you need to know, and then it's just a matter of hours and hours of practice. Right, so say I would come into the, oh, I can't, it come off by itself then. Right, I'm coming to, like, you keep the graver under pressure, you're pushing forward, and then the graver flies out of your hand, but no, right, you'll flip forward and then it pops the chip out. Anyway, let me do that again properly. Do his lip. Right, I've come to the end. I've come to the end. And oh, yeah, we worked that time. See, there's a chip there. You know, nickel's quite soft, and this isn't the best steel. Nice and sharp. This is really good if you was using I don't know what steel is this, because I tried to temper it, and it wouldn't temper. It just kind of was this hard, and it wouldn't go any harder or softer. Probably would have went softer, but if you was using high speed steel. Don't use carbide if you're beginning. I wouldn't advise to use carbide. It's, once you get used to it, it's brilliant because it lasts for ages, weeks sometimes. You don't need sharpen it, but you're gonna snap the tip, and it's so difficult to sharpen even with diamonds. You know, tiny little graver, you make a load of, your hands will be all black, and it takes like 40 minutes to sharpen one graver if you snap the tip. So stick to high speed steel or these. Let me show you the that packet of nails. It's just a generic, you know, out of a cheap shop. On the picture, you can just see his other eye. I don't think I'll do that. I might do it, but I don't think it matters if you leave it out. It doesn't matter. Maybe I will. So his eye, hang on. It's See, I'm referring back to the picture on the computer screen, but you've got that printout. You can have the printout if you're using a scope. It might not work that, but anyway, you can always do it. Alright, let's do one. Let's see if we can do a nice long line. Oh, some part of this I've engraved already. I said we're I had to change the vise. I don't follow it really, but you know, traditional kind of style hobo nickels follow as much of the original head, or if you do the tail sometimes, and they use as much as the original as possible. I'll just do whatever fancy, whatever's not there, or I'll put out of the way or carve deeper. See, some of that's what happens when you do a transfer and it's not that flat. The image doesn't come out very well, but that's the back of his t-shirt. Right, I'm going to try and speed up a bit, get this done, and then clean that off. And in the next video, I'll be using the flat graver. Cut some of the background away. I'm not sure how far I'll go with this, but see, if you just want to, you know, I wasn't really that interested in carving coins so much, but learning to hand engrave. But anyone who asked me about, I've only been engraving about, I think about 3 years now. But I do a lot of, you know, I spend a lot of time doing it. When anyone asks me about learning hand engraving, the first thing I say is, oh, you got to carve coins or engrave love tokens. Because, you know, when people learn to engrave, I've done it myself, they start off with a copper practice plate. And it's no, you know, it's not, you might do a nice engraving on a copper plate. What was going to be, you know, mine, I've cut them up, I think, and used them for something else in the end. But if you'd done the same thing on a coin, it's got a value and it will sell. You know, on eBay it will sell, might not sell if it's not a great one, or you're just starting, it might not be a great price. But I think I remember the first hobo nickel, or one of the first ones I ever did, went for $3 or £3, and the best one I did was it just last year sometime, which was Lincoln Memorial on a, you know, one of these coins. I carved the Lincoln Memorial, went for over $400. So you know, it's a way to you're learning, and if you like them so much you want to keep them, then it's even better. But if you're not that bothered, you want to sell them, you kind of create a fund, and all these carving these coins is paid for everything. I've got Lindsay templates and £500 microscope, you know, everything. It's paid for every, all the coins I get, it's paid for. And if you can make a decent image on a coin, then there's nothing you can't engrave. You know, if you're into gun engraving, you do a nice scroll work on a coin, then when you come to a gun, it'd be easy, or not easy, you know, it's harder work, a lot more work, but you know, the detail, you think nothing of it. Even when I do a dollar, you think, oh, I've got loads of room. I think we're nearly there. You always got to check when you I'll do some of these lines. When you engrave, you think you've done everything, and you clean off the lines, and you realise you've missed some. Oh, but you kind of, when you're not confident, you can make mistakes, like putting the lines back that aren't there. But I'm a lot better now. You kind of do it. I can't really draw, so I rely on something like this, like I get a designer, like a picture, for even a photograph or a cartoon or something. It's gone blunt again. I trace it, but you kind of, after a while, like, I know what an ear looks like now, so I probably could carve that. I've changed now, I'm just pushing. With pushing, I never push engrave. You know, the only time I've done it is doing these. I'm gonna clean that off now. I hear people, I was pushing, I stabbed myself. If your grave is sharp, my opinion is you almost no need to stab yourself. I actually recently did stab myself all day long, only because I was like waving the I was waving the graver around. Nothing to do with slipping or stabbing. I bet I've missed something. Let me it's hard to see actually, but let me blacken the lines up. So normally I would have that all smooth, and you wouldn't see the Indian at all. It's confusing, you still got the Indian eye here. Right, I'm gonna stop it now. I'll probably carry on myself, but I'll do that in a video for tomorrow. So what next is, if you haven't got your flat graver ready, that's the next one. So next is, you know, if you want to carry on going, you got the outline, is you're going to remove all that background as best you can. What you can do is, don't go straight to the flat graver, because it's kind of, you'll be ages doing it. So what you do is, you be tapping again. This has gone blunt. I need to sharpen it. I'll tell you what, I'll leave that for another video. Thanks. Right, let's just see what we've done. I don't think you're going to see it that well, actually. It's a shame. Oh yeah, that shows up a little bit there. I can see it. It's a start anyway, and you know, we'll have one done soon. Cheers, bye.